I too am a graduate of the New York Public Schools, and I have 5 older daughters who have all been through the system. From my eldest child, who graduated from high school in 1987, to my youngest daughter, who graduated in the year 2000. I have another son who is in St. Dominic's School with special needs. I believe that the state legislature made the right choice in 2002 when they changed the system to mayoral control, and I am here to urge you to renew the law in June. Thank you for the opportunity to testify today. I am here with several current and former students of Bronx Aerospace High School. These young people would probably not be in college right now if it had not been for mayoral control. All of us here today want to show support for that. I wanted to testify because I can remember clearly what public schools were like before we had a system of accountability. In my house, education was a priority, so I spent a lot of time volunteering and finding out what to do and what not to do. There was a lot of bureaucracy, and you ran into a lot of brick walls trying to get the best for your children. But that didn't stop parents like myself, who had a flexible schedule and could run around and do what needed to be done. The schools were in trouble then, and everyone knew it. My kids and I lived in Upper Manhattan, and they were going to school growing up, and the evidence of neglect was everywhere. Large, overcrowded schools where kids were lost in the crowd, rampant social promotion. Kids were pushed through school even though they barely knew how to read or write. And even then, the graduation rate was less than 30%. In the school where my son now attends, the graduation rate for Evander Childs was 28% last year. Now with the new smaller schools, our graduation rate at Bronx Aerospace has been above 90% for the last 3 years, and last year it was 94.7% graduation. Years would go by as things got worse. Chancellors would come and go, and news of corruption at the Board of Education was the norm. Why did all these things happen? Because nobody took charge and nobody was held accountable. The Board of Ed wasn't making any reforms, and the chancellors seemed powerless. The local school boards seemed to operate like family-run operations. Most parents didn't even think they had the right to go against the powers that be at the school board. When parents got frustrated, where could they turn to? They had no one. Blame was tossed back and forth, and nobody was hurt but the children. I have seen major improvements in these last 6 years, not just in this school, but in many other schools in my community. I see more children graduating. I see more children moving on to college. They are more prepared and don't have to spend as much time and money on remedial classes in college. More AP, which is advanced placement classes, are offered in schools now, and the SAT prep helps to prepare children for whatever they need. I couldn't get these programs for my older children unless I paid for them. Teachers are more qualified now that they have to be certified, and 100% of the teachers are certified. All of the students in the system, no matter what neighborhood they live in, can learn from great teachers. Principals are also held accountable for how parents are treated in all schools. Under the new system, every school has a parent coordinator like Ms. Joseph that is paid by the Department of Education, who is the liaison between the school and the parents. All parents can now fill out learning environment surveys each year. Principals have to pay attention to these because they lose points on their scores, on their progress report, if the parents are dissatisfied with the attention at the school. Bronx Aerospace is a new, small school in the system. It's not just a school, it's a family. The small setting helps the children keep up with their classwork. They're getting more individualized attention from caring teachers. They are doing better on exams, and they have a Saturday tutorial program that is available to help them with anything that they so desire. There are more children that go on to college, and I am sure that when my son is ready, he will be more prepared and will not be taking the remedial classes that his sisters took. We currently have students taking college courses during the day at Lehman and Host Hills Colleges along with their high school agenda. I do work closely with our principal, Captain Kirkwick, and I see how mayoral control has given her the flexibility to manage her budget so she can pay students to work as mentors, peer tutors, or administrative staff in the school. Not only does this extra income help students pay for senior dues and college visits, but it's a much better alternative to working at one of the local fast food places. At the school, they learn leadership, responsibility, and get some pride and accomplishment for what they get, for what they do, and how they perform, and this is something they could never get working at McDonald's. Because of mayoral control, Captain Kirkwig has more of a say on the teachers she hires. We have 6 teachers from the Teach for America program, and they are some of the most well-prepared teachers the school has ever seen. A couple of them have taken the initiative to start the honors program, which is what you see right here before you. We have quite a few of them. The students also qualify for more scholarship money. Once the system became about accountability, the old way of placing teachers because of tenure and not performance had to go. The captain would have been able to hire these, the captain would not have been able to hire these teachers before 2002, but they have been a tremendous asset to the school and more importantly to the students. I know that significant changes have been proposed to the law, changes that I think will help to take us right back to the failure of the old system. We can't have mayoral control if the mayor does not control the panel on education policy or the PEP. We believe mayoral control should continue as it is. We believe that modifications to mayoral control will mean that the mayor is no longer in control. We have made these gains in achievement as a direct result of the policies the mayor and chancellor have enacted. We do not want any changes at all. What will we gain by having more people on the PEP, eliminating the mayor's majority, and adding term limits? The blame game of roadblocks from the old Board of Education will be reinstated. Who will take responsibility if things don't work out? Few parents in the entire system even know who is on the PEP. While the PEP can hide behind a cloud of ambiguity, everyone knows who the mayor is. I know that I would rather have someone I elect make the decisions on our public schools rather than someone that's just selected. Please renew mayoral control this June. Thank you very much for listening to us all. That's it. Thank you.
Our next speaker will be Jacqueline Wyans from the Educational Consultant and Reporter for theinsideschools.org. And may I ask you, please, we have several people still, and if we keep reading, we're not going to get through everyone. So I appreciate if you can summarize. That would be neat. Thanks.
Yes, I definitely will not be reading because most of what I'm going to have to say to you today, I'm sure that most of the parents, educators, and students in here already know. So I am just going to hit a few highlights. My name is Jacqueline Wayans. And indeed, I have here that I worked with InsideSchools.org, which allowed me to visit over 150 New York City public schools. Some of them are sitting here today. I'm also one of the commissioners on for school governance, the final report that was done through the Public Advocate's Office. And most importantly, I'm a mom of 3 kids who are in the public school system and currently running for a spot on the CEC, even though it is a position that doesn't wield a lot of power at this point in time. One of the things that I can say without a doubt is that overwhelmingly the findings on retaining mayoral control was there. We spoke to about over 100 stakeholders, but overwhelmingly, again and again, it must be done with necessary modifications to the existing law. I will not regurgitate many of the things that was said here today, but I do want to talk a little bit about a legislative example of how not having parent and community input can lead to years of series of changes that is not healthy for our students. And my highlight would be in 2004, Mayor Bloomberg implemented the Impact Schools Initiative, which doubled the amount of police officers in the schools and instituted a zero tolerance policy. Now, when parents hear zero tolerance, they actually, at first, were very calm. They felt this is wonderful. This is going to cut down on crime. This is going to take any violence or drugs out of our schools. However, the legislation was written very loosely. And so it became very evident quite quickly within a couple of months that there wasn't clarity as to who had jurisdiction when things happened in the school system, so the principals or the police officers that were called in to handle the situations. It wasn't even very clear as to what situations police officers should or could be called into the school systems for. And so such an important decision as the Impact School Initiative went through without any real viable input by parent or community. And I can tell you as a parent who has three kids in school, I personally had a situation with my own child. And as I go through the CCs and meet parents, they're constantly asking me about bullying. Children are unprotected. And oftentimes what happens, it's the very ones who have been bullied who act out, and they're the ones who get called and taken out of the school in cuffs. And it's not doing justice to our youth, and it creates a longer and a greater problem, which they're now looking into, that's called a cradle to jail pipeline, which advocates for children and the NCLU are also looking into. Okay, and this is very serious because our children are supposed to feel protected in school. They're supposed to feel safe. They're not supposed to feel as if they could be searched, a random search at any moment. And this is happening as young as middle school. And unfortunately, there have been cases of even elementary school kids being taken out in handcuffs. So this is something where the legislation needs to be tightened up. I would also take a look at the issue regarding parents' voice. While many are saying we don't want to go back to the old ways, and I agree with that, that has been said over and over again, we cannot discount the value that parents have. And one of the things that we heard of in our hearings over and over again was that maybe there should be a parent union of sorts, a parent sort of like the old parent urban association, but of course with modifications there as well. But the idea is that you would have representation in each boroughs made up of community members as well as parents and grandparents and aunts that would be available to decide on policy issues and really have a voice. Also, I believe at this time in our country, we should be utilizing technology in a far greater way than we are when it comes to parent input. We have millions of people voting, you know, for American Idol and things like that. There's no reason why parents who are working two jobs or long days should not have the opportunity through teleconferencing or webinars to be able to come in and be a part and lend their voice to a community hearing or meeting that is going on and be a part of it that way in the comfort of their home as opposed to really scheduling the meetings. I think one of the overwhelming issues here in the Bronx is that parents do care, but they are working very hard and they have, you know, a lot of times more than one job, more than one child, more than one school. So all of these are factors that really need to be considered. And lastly, I would just say that as a parent and a commission member, I can safely say that the stakeholders of this city do not want a school governance system that is ripe for abuse. We don't want any one mayor to be able to have complete control without checks and balance, without transparency, even an IBO to look at the data and the financial situations that's going on with the schools. Thank you.
Yes. We have to take one person out of order because she has to be gone almost immediately. And that is Carmen Alvarez, Vice President, Elementary Education for the UFT. And while she's coming up, I would say to our last speaker that some of us, now me in particular, I'm not from New York City, and the way that parents reach out to get their concerns addressed in almost every other place outside of the Big Five is a model, I think, that works in every, you know, like 700 school districts in our state where the parent can bring their concern to the classroom teacher and then to the principal and after the principal to the superintendent And that is a model that we see throughout the state of New York, and I think it's one that we could even look at for New York City. Thank you.
Am I on? All right. Good afternoon. My name is Carmen Alvarez. I am the United Federation of Teachers UFT Vice President for Special Education and co-chair of the union's multipartisan school governance task force. On behalf of my members, I want to thank Senator Suzi Oppenheimer and the distinguished members of this committee for this opportunity to share our views on the school governance law that allows for mayoral control of the New York City's public school. We must first and foremost be focused on our educational mission and improving outcomes for children. That means our fundamental goal should be to create a governance structure that supports schools, educators, and most important, create safe, high-quality learning environments that help children prepare for college and for life. And of course, to support the families of these young people. UFT President Randy Weingarten often speaks from her heart on how crucial it is for all students to receive a quality education. And that is precisely the approach we would like to take as we frame this discussion on mayoral control. I applaud the young people who are in this program. I applaud the teachers in these schools. I applaud the administrators in this school. But they are existing, and they should not exist at the expense of other children. And that is what the policies of this Department of Ed is doing at this point in time. The UFT's position is very simple. The governor and the state legislature should reauthorize the school governance law, but with modifications. We believe the mayor should still appoint the chancellor, control the budget, and drive the policy. But we also believe that the system needs more checks and balances and transparency. Having a mayor who took responsibility for the schools promoted public education for the good, but it also gave us major problems. For example, from the arbitrary removal of central board members to shifts on issues like gifted and talented bus routes, kindergarten, and admissions. If he had simply spoken to the community, the parents, the educators, he didn't have to go through those missteps. So we have to put something in there. It is also something when groups such as My UFT campaign, There Is No Excuse, were inundated with complaints about special education services not being provided. Let me give you some data the chancellor won't tell you. Right now, the graduation rate in 4 years for all students is 52%. For African American students, 47%. For Hispanic students, 43%. For students with disabilities, 20%. For English language learners, 24%. Let me give you another one. And this is from the state as well. In terms of a Regents diploma, 37% of the students, all students from the Board of Ed get a Regents diploma. African American, 28%. Hispanics, 26%. Students with disabilities, 5%. English language learners, 11%. And this is under these past 7 years. You have to understand, where are these young people going? They drop out at the eighth grade. Where are they going? You have a pipeline that's going to the prisons. We need to redirect those pipelines so they can go to those schools that you saw these young people. We have to make a change in the law. So let me go on. So one of the questions you asked, Ms. Oppenheimer, was what are the things that are happening in the system? And I can tell you, we've had, some person had coined the Department of Education as the Department of Reorganization. We're going through another reorganization, but the last one was the most detrimental to students with disabilities, English language learners, and at-risk students. What it did was, it took all the support structures, like the superintendents, removed them, and made them 15 1,500 independent schools. What it has created in many of the schools is a climate of intimidation, fear, and lawlessness. So where you have a school in Manhattan that allows parents to go in, you'll have another borough where you have principals who won't. So where do you get the policy to do that? You need to change how the policies are decided and ultimately implemented. So knowing all that we do, these are some of the recommendations. We recommend the makeup of the Central Panel for Education, PEP, be changed by creating more inclusive structure, more voices to be heard. We favor fixed terms, so there are no decisions where you're going to be fearfully removed for arbitrary and capricious issues, that the chancellor is not the chair. We additionally recommend empowering the panel to hold hearings on expense and capital budgets, and not at the expense of the public being heard. I've been at these PEP panels, and the chancellor will have all his people from the Department of Ed speak, and when the parents are ready to speak, he says, sorry, it's a long time. We'll talk about it next time. You just can't disenfranchise people who take this opportunity to speak. And I am telling you, I am a former school board member from District 3. And my responsibility area as a school board member was special ed and bilingual ed. And I can tell you, in that district, we took real responsibility in trying to solve issues. Were there problems in that system? Absolutely. There was more for the vocal parents at the lower end of the district than there were at the upper end of the districts. And I agree there has to be changes, but it wasn't all bad. Excuse me. Right now, communities do not have a voice in school governance whatsoever, which we know contradicts the law you put together. We recommend that the state legislature re-empower school leadership teams, district leadership teams, and community educational councils, which we changed all their titles, so they're able to carry out all their responsibility as written per your state law. Parents must have a role in decisions affecting their children and have their grievances addressed promptly. District superintendents, who for a long time served as the important link between their communities and the Central Department of Ed, should be re-empowered. Let's look at the swine flu situation. Let's look at the swine flu situation. We had 1,500 principals who did not know who to go to. They did not know who to go to. What were the criteria to close a school? What should I do? They had to rely on the UFT because we were structured to do that. If you had superintendents, as your law has set forth, they would have had a responsible accountability person to go to. So you really have to look at what needs to be put back in place and shored up. Because just because you have it in the law, you can see that the mayor and the Department of Ed will do what they want anyway. So you've got to do something that ensures the DOE follows the letter and the spirit of the law. Over the next few weeks, we hope everyone can dial down the polemics and the talk and get past the politics of conflict and work together to find a smart way to strengthen the school governance law. I think that if the people's voices are heard, and if people are collaborated with, if this system is transparent and people are accountable, then finally we are on the right track. Thank you.
Thank you very much. A lot of the things you discussed are the various things that we are talking about. Having district superintendents be in their districts, have a relationship with the 40-odd principals of their schools in the district so that there is a connection. They know each other. They work collaboratively. Yeah, those are things that we are definitely looking at.
Thank you very much from your mouth to the legislature. It'll be fantastic. And I hope you take a lot of the recommendations that are coming down, because everybody has been thoughtful from the very different commissions, and I'm sure you're reading it. Thank you very much again. Mm-hmm.
Next, if we could please hear from Alan Cohn, principal of PS 69.
Ready? Good afternoon, Senator. Thank you for giving me this opportunity to speak this afternoon. I will be very brief. My name is Alan Cohn. I am the principal of PS 69. Located in the Soundview section of the Bronx. I am proud to say that I am a product of the New York City Public Schools. 6 years ago, I was a newly appointed principal to assign to a failing school that was about to be taken over by the state. I am very happy to report for the past 3 years, I've received 3 consecutive A's on my school progress report, and my school has moved over 50 points in mathematics and over 40 points in ELA. Additionally, we received an award from the New York State Department for high-performing achievement gap-closing school. I expect to receive another A this year on my progress report. Our fifth grade score in ELA was 94.6 on our recent ELA exam, the highest in Community School District 8. As a result of mayoral control, the Leadership Academy was established. As a new principal, the Academy helped me play a vital role in developing my leadership skills. As a result of mayoral control, principals became the CEOs of their schools. In return, I gladly accepted accountability. Mayoral control of the school system has set in place an accountability system that is rigorous and demanding while focusing on the needs of the students we serve. As a result of mayoral control, clear goals and objectives have become the paradigm for school success in all New York City schools. As a result of mayoral control, we now have an essential position in our schools, the parent coordinator. It is a critical position that allows parents input and voice into our school culture. At PS 69, we like to say we are partners in educating the minds and hearts of our children. Donna Salerno, sitting next to me, is our school's parent coordinator. She has created an environment where parents see themselves as an integral part of the school community, as decision makers and key stakeholders in their children's educational lives. She has trained parents in conflict resolution, which has helped us create a common language and a shared vision for our school community. She has trained our parents in a fluency program and our parents work throughout our school building. In addition, she does a needs assessment at the beginning of the year and the parents select the workshops that they want. For example, this year there's a book and a bagel. Once a month they do a book club. And there's a how-to program, how to help children for ELA exams, how to help children do homework, and many other programs that are just too much to mention at this point. As a result of mayoral control, school-based budgeting allows the principal to look at the individual needs of his or her own school and utilize the funds to meet specific academic needs of their students. Successful schools do not follow a template, but rather look at the individual needs of the students. I am able to hire my own staff and make decisions around curriculum and instruction. As a result of mayoral control, schools were able to choose the organizations which they want to partner with. This endeavor of meeting students' academic needs, I had the opportunity to join the Empowerment Network, where there were minimal constraints and more accountability. I then moved to a PSO, a private support organization, CEIPEA, which best meets the needs of my school community. Is the system perfect? No. but mayoral control has brought a once-failing system, common standards, rigorous accountability, functionality, safety, and most important, equity and core values. I therefore strongly support the continuation of mayoral control. Thank you.
Thank you, and thank you for all this good news. Okay, next we have Monica Major, President, CEC 11, Parents Commission.
Thank you. And good afternoon to the members of the Senate, and thank you for still being here. We appreciate that. Again, my name is Monica Major. I am the president of CEC 11 here in the Bronx, and I'm also a member of the Parent Commission on School Governance. And, you know, during this afternoon, I've heard so much testimony about the good things that are happening in the schools, and I think every parent in this city, and especially Bronx parents, I mean, we like to hear that, and we like to know that that's happening with our students. Unfortunately, it's not happening enough, and we would like to see that happen in more schools. So the position that I have taken in working with the Parent Commission, it reflects that we want the good things that are happening in one or two schools to happen to as many parents and students as possible. So I just want to tell you about the Parent Commission. We began the Parent Commission last spring because we believed that there was a need for a task force to address the issues of school governance from the parents' point of view. Starting in September, we've been meeting weekly and monthly, and we've had forums featuring several representatives from the education field whose insights have helped inform our recommendations. The Parent Commission on School Governance has developed what we consider the most comprehensive set of proposals, and that is based on most of our commission are parents who are actually in the system. We believe that parents should have a partnership, not a dictatorship, in the New York City public school system. Parents are the most important stakeholders, and parents and students are the most important stakeholders in the public school system. This administration has disempowered parents at all levels and stripped them of decision-making powers in a systematic and highly destructive manner. Our proposals are designed to ensure that we parents have a real voice in how our students are educated. We have several components to our proposal, if you haven't had a copy. This is a proposal that was put together by parent and education advocates. There was no funding. We go to Staples to copy it, and we take turns copying it. This is something that parents have sat down and worked very hard at putting together because we live this system on a daily basis. And when it comes to districts, despite the fact that the community school districts were specifically continued in state law, the administration has essentially dissolved them and mandated that superintendents spend at least 90% of their time coaching schools outside of their districts on how to analyze test score data. We would like to restore superintendents to their essential role to helping to support schools and parents within their district, by specifying in the law that they be obligated to spend at least 90% of their time within their district, taking a leadership role there. We also want to put high schools back within the geographic district so that they too will have a voice as we move forward. Right now, there are decisions being made in ways that ignore the needs of parents and communities. And the thoughtless and unilateral way in which the administration is making these decisions are literally tearing communities apart, as you've seen here today. We should be able to sit down and talk about what's works for the community. Whether it's a charter school, whether it's an ELL parent, we should be able to do that together as a community. On the CECs, we propose that we strengthen the CECs. All parents should have a right to vote. Each CEC should have a seat reserved for a special education parent, a parent of English language learner, and a high school parent. So we're asking that you expand the CEC. CEC should also have the authority to approve the siting, closing, and opening of all new schools, including charter schools, in each district. School leadership teams were established by the state to develop, through consensus, a comprehensive education plan and school-based budgets based on those plans. Parent input has been eviscerated in regards to the school leadership teams. In December 2008, Commissioner Mills, who found that the chancellor had indeed violated state law by taking away the authority from the SLTs, told him that he had to rewrite the regulations. The chancellor has issued a revised regulation, but it is as bad as the previous one. We want to strengthen and clarify the role of SLTs in state law, so that future chancellors cannot attempt to take away their rightful authority again, and so that parents have a real voice in decision-making at the school level. Parent voices need to be strengthened at the central level. Other stakeholder groups like principals and teachers have unions, but we have no independent parent organization that will speak for our interests. That's why we propose an independent citywide parent organization with the dedicated source of public funding to speak for parents on issues of great concern and also to provide training for individual parents on how to advocate for their children, as well as train CECs and SLT members. I just want to make it clear that not all schools are created equal, not all communities are created equal, not all parents are created equal, and not all students are receiving an equal education in the city of New York.
Thank you, Senator Oppenheimer, and for holding these hearings today. My name is Leonie Hameson. I'm Executive Director of Class Size Matters and a public school parent and a member of the Parent Commission. I'm here today to speak about our proposals for checks and balances and accountability necessary if our students are going to get an adequate education. One-man rule, as we currently have, or two-man rule, doesn't work for any level of government. It doesn't work for our federal government, it doesn't work in our state legislature, and it doesn't work for our schools. We propose that instead of mayoral dictatorship, we have a mayoral partnership between the mayor and parents. We propose a Board of Education reformed so that there are six elected parents, one seat reserved for a special ed parent, five political appointees, including three from the mayor, and four members of the Board of Education who will be collectively chosen by the other members in order to fill in areas that they need in terms of expertise and experience. And we're hoping that this collaboration will lead to a more consensus-based atmosphere on the board. We also believe that the chancellor should not be picked unilaterally by the mayor, but the board as a whole should pick three candidates of which the mayor would select one. We also need three separate independent offices to provide critical oversight and ensure accountability and transparency in the system. We need an inspector general to investigate all allegations of corruption, malfeasance, and mismanagement, even at the very highest levels of the Department of Education, and to report their findings directly to the public. Right now, we have a special investigator for schools appointed by the mayor and reporting only to the mayor and the chancellor. Only 6% of his substantiated investigations have been reported directly to the public. We propose that the inspector general be appointed by the district attorneys collectively of all the five boroughs and, again, be independently funded. There's also a critical need for an ombudsperson to respond to complaints from parents that cannot be resolved at the district or the school level. Currently, the chancellor tells parents to email him if they have a problem. Clearly, that's not a realistic solution for the largest school system in the country. The ombudsperson should also report twice a year to the board on the particular type and number of complaints he or she has received and provide suggestions on reforms that would address these complaints in a more systematic manner. We also need an independent accountability office that will have full access to internal student-level data and report on test scores, graduation rates, and the like. Right now is Bob Tobias, former head of testing for New York City Schools, told our commission there is a crisis of confidence in the information reported by the Department of Education. You've heard a lot about the state test scores here today. Every school is bragging that they're all level threes and fours. Well, we don't trust the recent state test scores, and we have a lot of evidence to show that in the past, those kinds of increases have not been matched by progress in the more reliable measures of the NAEP, the national assessments produced by the U.S. Department of Education. Indeed, our achievement levels on those assessments have been flat since the Bloomberg-Klein policies were put into place in every subject and grade tested except for fourth grade math, and there was no narrowing of the achievement gap either. Indeed, despite claims of spectacular progress when one analyzes New York City students compared to other large urban districts, New York City students have actually fallen in comparison to all other districts. In fact, New York was the only urban district in which all of these groups did worse in eighth grade reading than they had in 2003. We've also heard a lot about increases in graduation rates over the past 7 years. Together with Jennifer Jennings, a graduate student at Columbia, we released a report a few weeks ago showing that while graduation rates have increased, so have discharge rates, that is, number of students in our high schools who have left our schools without diplomas but who are never counted as dropouts, and in fact are never counted at all in DOE's graduation calculations. In fact, the percentage of all students discharged increased from 7.5% for the class of 2000 to over 21%. A total of 142,000 New York students have been discharged between 2000 and 2007, over 20,000 of them for the class of 2007 alone. There are actually 32 different categories of discharges in this DOE system, yet because the administration reports them only as one group, and the discharge records are not independently audited, it is impossible to distinguish legitimate discharges from those that might be better understood as dropouts. In fact, there are several categories of students that right now are called discharges in the New York City public school system that would be considered dropouts by the federal government accountability system, including students who transfer to GED programs, students who leave school at 21, or because they have become pregnant, or because they have been expelled. We also found that the increase in the overall discharge rate has been driven primarily by a doubling in the discharge rate for students in their first year of high school. This is a very troubling finding because it's illegal in most cases to discharge students before the age of 17 unless they can prove that they've gone to another degree holding institution. Anyway, in my testimony, I have disaggregated discharge rates by ELL and special ed status and by special discharge rates in the Bronx and the adjusted graduation rate if all the discharges were counted as dropouts, which would be actually not necessarily the case because some of them are legitimate discharges. But the general education graduation rate, instead of being 62%, would be 47%. So I'd like to give this over to Josh Caron, who's going to talk a little bit about a couple more of our recommendations.
Good afternoon. I do not have written comments because I was a last-minute substitute for some other parent commission members who could not make it. Apologize for that, but I believe I'll be able to speak on message. My name is Josh Caron. I'm a Manhattan Borough President appointee to the District 6 Community Education Council, as well as a member of the Parent Commission. District 6 is noteworthy for two reasons. One, it was the birthplace of the Campaign for Fiscal Equity, and I've worked closely with Robert Jackson for 15 years on that matter. Secondly, it is the district with the highest number and percentage of English language students in the entire state of New York, not just the city of New York. And so what the results have been over the last 8 years for our district are very significant. One example which buttresses what was said is that though, according to the DOE statistics themselves, reading scores seem to have gone up, only 30% of our students, eighth grade students, are at state standard in science, and only 16% are at state standard in social studies. So the fact that most of them don't even know that there's such thing as a state senate is indicated by those kinds of scores. Yet 12 out of 13 middle schools in my district were given an A or a B on their report card grades, despite that. And I can show you that DOE comprehensive education plan that has that. Now, as part of our proposal, there are two specific areas that I'm going to speak about. One has to do with the role for special education students and parents. You heard from Carmen Alvarez of the UFT how under this system there has been a lack of fulfillment for services for special ed. One of our members whose place I'm taking, Patricia Connolly, is on the Citywide Council for Special Education and has indicated that there are 17 different entities which govern special education matters, so that accountability is completely absent. And we talk about having to have a deputy chancellor whose sole focus is concentrated on students for special needs. This would be part of an integrated structure whereby there would be on CECs a set-aside seat for a parent of special education students to make sure that they are represented. And all the way through, what we have established as an independent parent organization, which would provide the training for people that would be on both the CECs and the Board of Education. On that Board of Education, there would also be a seat for special education parent to ensure that those policy discussions are engaged by people who have firsthand experience in this system, which affects probably 15 to 20% of all New York City students. I don't think that the independent parent organization was spoken about, was it?
Yes.
Yep, forgive me. There is, in my lifetime of 40 years of involvement, been centralization, decentralization, and recentralization. There have been chancellors who have been educators, there have been chancellors who have not been educators. And there's been one constant through all that change. Regardless of who the chancellor has been or the system of governance, 50% of the students in this system have not been served. So what we talk about is that governance is essential, but is not by itself. That it's necessary, but it is not sufficient. So we have a concept which goes beyond governance, which is modeled after the Campaign for Fiscal Equity, with which I'm so closely familiar. And that is that there needs to be, from the legislature, a home rule that allows New York City to establish in its own city charter an education constitution which articulates the vision and mandates for this system. I went to school in Binghamton, New York. We don't tell people in Binghamton how to run their school system, and we ask that New York City be given its ability to establish mandates which will ensure, regardless of who is the chancellor, regardless of the system of governance, that every school has a science lab, every school has a library, every school has an art room, every school has a gymnasium. I can tell you in my district that is not true. Robert Jackson worked more than 15 years to reduce class size. Under this system of one person rule, and I'm headed down to the capital budget hearing at City Hall that he's chairing after this meeting, that has not occurred. There's been little reduction in class size in my district, which still has 25% of its classes in many of the grades have more than 23 students in elementary school, more than 27 students in middle school, and I can provide all of that data to you as well. We need a mandate that ensures that classes are at the size that the Campaign for Fiscal Equity talked about. We need to have a mandate that there'll be alternative sources of analysis and of assessment so that it's not just test prep, but that students are evaluated according to portfolios as well as many other measures. We need a mandate that talks about the demography of the teaching staff. Under this chancellor, there has been a vast reduction in the teachers of color in this system. And we want to make sure that the system reflects the kind of student body that it has. All of these could be made possible by a constitution, and we ask that the legislature set up a commission to enable that constitution to draft, that commission to draft such a constitution.
Thank you.
It is the state law, all the things that you're looking for. So the question is, how can you avoid, how can you be avoiding state law? That's the issue.
New York City.
Yeah. Next we have to hear from, and if you would please just give us a summation. Peter McNally, Executive Vice President, Council of School Supervisors and Administrators.
Good afternoon, Senator Oppenheimer, and thank you for this opportunity. I am Peter McNally, the Executive Vice President at CSA, the union that represents all principals and assistant principals in the system. I will not read from the testimony. I'll just give you the highlights. What I'm going to speak to you today is in support of the legislation that will be introduced very shortly by Assemblymember Alan Maisel, a former CSA member and assistant principal who has drafted the legislation in cooperation with CSA. The highlights of that legislation, first on the panel for educational policy. The central board must be redesigned to expand representation. CSA proposes a board of 13 members with the majority, 7 members appointed by the mayor, then 1 by each borough president and 1 by the city council. PEP members should be appointed to a fixed term. This measure will increase transparency and participation in the decision-making process, resulting in better educational policy decisions for all our students. Second major point is on the community school districts and their superintendents. The chancellor or board may not assign to community superintendents duties that are outside of their district. The community superintendent should be fully responsible for the work within their districts. Also, the district office should be located within the district and sufficiently staffed so that it can be responsive to the parent community. Community superintendents should also be appointed to fixed terms of 2 years so that there is stability within those school districts. Well-established and stable community superintendents will strengthen parental and community engagement in our schools. The third major point is parental participation in the opening and closing of schools. We do believe that the DOE should give reasonable notice of a planned closure or opening of a school and submit an impact study to the CDEC on the opening and closing of schools, including the addition of new schools and charter schools to existing buildings. The chancellor should be required to respond to the CDEC's recommendations in a public forum. The last, which you have heard from many of the people that have given testimony this morning, is about transparency. The legislature should establish an independent school performance data and budget office, or empower the independent budget office to gather, analyze, and provide comprehensive and timely information about the school system and about all data and accountability initiatives, as well as all DOE budgets, centrally, district, as well as in the schools. Last but not least, we do believe that this hearing here is a very important one because of the sunset provision in the last law. We are strongly recommending that there be another sunset provision so that we continue to learn and to improve as we move forward. We recommend that the sunset be the same as this for 6 years. CSA applauds the Senate Education Committee for understanding the importance of this public input, and we are available for any additional insight and assistance as the Senate Committee is in need of. Thank you. We strongly recommend a system with stronger checks and balances. I would just also like to respond to a testimony that was given a little earlier concerning the swine flu, just so that there is no misunderstandings. The principals did receive direct communication from the chancellor via Principals Weekly, in addition to an emergency memo, and in addition to that, a webinar to over 200 schools that were directly affected. All principals had been given direction to report information on a daily basis immediately to their community superintendents as well as the health directors at the integrated service centers.
Thanks very much. That's pretty much how it works outside of
exactly.
The Big Five. The superintendent says, you know, it's going to be 5 feet of snow and it's going to close our schools. I mean, the decision
right.
is made at that level.
Well, also in our city, this decision has been made from the direction of the mayor through the Department of Health. It's the Department of Health that determines. The Department of Education is required to
right.
give the information to the Department of Health.
Okay.
Okay.
Thank you, and thank you for the work you've done. I've been reading the tomes that you sent. Okay. Not you particularly, but the group has sent.
Okay, and we are available for any further assistance. Thank you very much.
Next is Mona Davids. She's the founder of the New York City Charter Parents.
Thank you. Good afternoon, everyone. I would like to thank the State Senate Education Committee for providing this opportunity for parents to provide input on such a critical topic. My name is Mona Davids, and I am the proud parent of an honor roll fifth grader who attends PS 160 in Co-op City. I am the co-president of the Parent Association of PS 160, and I am the founder of the NYC Charter Parents Association. My daughter, Maymuna Davids, will be attending the Equality Charter School in September. I am, at this moment, a traditional public school parent, and come September, I will be a public charter parent. I sit here with my fellow traditional public school parent, Mr. Luna, whose daughter here attends PSMS 279. We are both parents. In September, I will be a public charter parent. My friend here, Mr. Luna, will be a traditional public school parent. 25 years ago, my family emigrated to the United States of America from South Africa. I was 10 years old, the same age as my daughter is now. This was during the apartheid era, when black South Africans did not receive equal access to a quality education. My family moved so that my brother and I could have a quality education, so that we can have choices. I started NYC Charter Parents to help give public charter parents a voice and a platform to exercise our civil right of providing a quality education for our children by having choice, a choice of schools for our children to attend. This debate is not about charter schools. It's about making schools better for everyone. As a parent, I want to be able to send my child to the best school around. I don't care if it's a charter school, a specialized school, a small school, a large school. It just needs to be a good school. These last seven years under mayoral control, the Department of Education has helped open 350 new schools, traditional and charter. When parents have good options, of schools to send their kids. We all win. These new schools and our other schools in the city are working. State test scores show the great progress our students have made. Graduation rates have increased. 15% more high school graduates are attending CUNY schools and receiving a college education. I strongly support renewing mayoral control of public schools so we can continue the progress we have made these last 7 years. And when I say renewing mayoral control of public schools, I mean not in name only. We need to make sure we're maintaining the system that's allowed so much innovation these past 7 years. A system free from politics and bureaucracy, one where we put our children first. I strongly ask you, Senator Oppenheimer, to keep the pedal for education policy intact as is, in order for the mayor to really be in charge of the schools, she or he needs to control the central governing board. If you take away the mayoral majority on the panel for education policy, you will have mayoral control in name only. I thank you once again for allowing parents, educators, school principals, and community leaders to speak about this important issue.